Okay, since you can hear me, I guess we can start. Thank you for joining. I'm actually very pleased to see the turnout this afternoon. It's fantastic to see the level of interest here. Over the next, hopefully, 40 minutes or so, if I still have them, we'll be covering the top 10 things NetApp has learned about being in the OpenStack marketplace. And just a caveat up front, this is not a vendor pitch. We're not trying to sell any NetApp hardware or software here. It's literally our observations as developers, as participants and contributors to this particular community. So brief bio on who I am. I've been at NetApp about 15 years or so now. It'll be 15 years at the end of the month. I've seen a lot of change within the industry, the storage industry, the data management industry in particular. I've also been privileged to actually witness our participation in various open source communities, various industry associations and standards efforts. This is a very brief bio of the particular industry association standards and open source communities I've been personally involved in. Just so you know, NetApp actually maintains the entire network portion of the Linux kernel. We actually fund that development entirely as our contribution to the open source community, as well as the ability for us to leverage and introduce new technologies. We're very actively involved in the BSD community as well. If you know anything about our core technology data ONTAP, you'll know that it's now based entirely on the BSD kernel, subsets at least of the BSD kernel. And of course, we're involved in Hadoop and the OpenStack community as well. So this is just a brief bio on what I've been doing. One of the things that I'm not going to touch directly on here, but it's very, very relevant, one of the first standards, I believe, first cloud standards to exist I was able to help introduce to the marketplace, that's something called CDMI, Cloud Data Management Interface. And it's an abstraction, a superset of both Swift and S3. RESTful interface, very, very well thought out and well defined. And that's something, if you have questions after the session about how it might apply to this community here, how it's being adopted globally, I'm happy to answer that as well. So here's what I do hope to accomplish today. It's really all about perspective. It's about learning what we've observed over the past, I'd say, 18 months or so at least, that I recall us being very, very actively involved, and it dates back to Diablo, as I'm finding out. We've been involved in this marketplace from a number of perspectives. So I'm going to reflect the customer perspective, then the storage and infrastructure industry perspective. We'll talk about some of the workloads and actually some of the development workflows in particular. The competitive aspect here is really what choice we're seeing customers make with regards to all things cloud, whether they directly apply to OpenStack or whether they apply to the broader cloud marketplace such as it is. And we'll talk about the thriving ecosystem that's evolving within the OpenStack community as well. So without further ado, there's actually a very, very good blog that was done by one of the VMware engineers a little while ago, talking about really the mentality of the cloud-erati or the cloud community. And this is something that I resonated with very, very directly when I read it about 6 or 9 months ago when it was published. And that's the notion of, if not specifically geographically, but a state of mind that exists within the technical community here. We're at a conference here that's already West Coast based. All of us are, you know, highly technically involved people. Many of us are developers. We have to continuously remind ourselves, and this happens to me fortunately every time I meet with a customer, particularly outside of one of the key high-tech hubs, whether it's in Middle America or Middle Earth, so to speak, whether it's overseas in certain parts of Europe or APAC, Asia-Pac, and so forth. I'm continuously reminded that the level of risk tolerance, the level of early adoptness, if you will, is so much lower. It's almost night and day outside of the outside of the community that we're directly involved in the self-fulfilling loop and feedback loop that we have here, that we really have to appreciate how adoption, really, really rapid adoption that we're accustomed to here in some of these really rapid development cycles, is not the norm outside of our particular demographic. And that's a very, very important thing to appreciate as we actually try and make OpenStack a mainstream technology, make it as ubiquitous as the word Windows to the average layperson, and associate it with cloud. Now, before we actually look outside, I felt it was very instructive to look within. What does a typical, and I actually categorize NetApp now as roughly a $7 billion, 13,000 person company. We're the classic mid-cap company nowadays. So looking within to find out how NetApp's IT department actually segments their cloud budget allocation, their cloud resource staffing, and of course, most importantly, the cloud services they offer me as an IT user inside the company. We quickly see that one of the first things that we were focusing on is NetApp IT, I should say, because I'm not part of NetApp IT, but that NetApp IT focuses on is being able to rapidly provision, manage, and reallocate existing third-party applications, effectively binaries, not source code. So not so much a development mindset, very much an operational mindset of existing technology. This slide is sort of drawn to scale, so that consumes about 20-25%. By far, when you're talking to a business person, when you're talking to a business unit lead, or actually the average user inside an enterprise, by far, the biggest association of cloud is with software as a service, more than infrastructure and way more than platform as a service. And of course, by far, the leading shining example of that is our friend Benioff's company, Salesforce.com. And essentially, what we're seeing here is the fact that there's a large Salesforce-dominated cloud that a lot of IT budgets, a lot of IT staff is associated with managing, with governing, with setting policies for. And there's a whole bunch of somewhat random other third-party applications. So at NetApp, we use Workday, we use ServiceNow, we're using a couple of the marketing ones, Mercado, Radian6, list goes on. And of course, some pretty familiar names at the bottom there with regards to, you know, high volume, high profile collaborative software as a service technologies, such as Twitter, Facebook, LinkedIn, or so forth. And again, this is drawn more or less proportionally to budget and staffing scale. So this is really what's left over when it comes to really flexible, agile infrastructure clouds. And as you probably know, there's certainly no default assumption that all of this is going to be OpenStack. There's a huge proponent in the company that, you know, within IT that wants it to be, for some obvious reasons that we all share in common here. But this is a competitive landscape. There's actually a bunch of different categories involved. And this is really how we, now focusing outside of IT, actually on the engineering side of the house, particularly in my group, the office of the CTO, this is how we view the marketplace. We actually view it from a business perspective on through the technical, and you'll actually find the flow of this presentation is very much around a business view and a strategic view, and I'll hone in more narrowly down on the technical perspectives as we get to number one. So from an industry perspective, if you look at sort of the top and bottom of the slide first, you'll see very, very different business model approaches towards industry delivery of cloud services and cloud infrastructures. At the very top, the buy and operate category is all about using the power of your balance sheet, using a lot of actual non-technical assets and non-technical people you might have in your company to buy third-party or implement open source technologies, if you will, but primarily buy commercial technology with all the commercial associations around sales support, installation support, post-installation support, and so forth, professional services. That whole sales model is built into that nature of cloud deployment. So think of it as third-party commercial cloud technologies. At the very bottom, you've got the polar opposite effect of folks that essentially have data as their business. Data doesn't support their business, it is their business, almost in entirety. And as a result, the business model means that you can justify a lot more investment in actually hiring the engineers and hiring the expertise and developing nowadays, literally from the silicon on up, all the technology you need, custom tailored, custom fit, bespoke if you're from overseas, for your specific set of requirements. So it's almost a polar opposite where there is very little, if any, third-party technology at some of these companies. There's very little, if any third-party commercial technology at some of these companies. A lot of it is based on open source, historically software, and with the open compute movement, even some open source hardware right now. Backblaze, for any of you that know it, is a really interesting backup as a service provider, and they're one of the first to actually open source their hardware disk shelf specs. So a lot of that, a lot of those themes are really filtering into the business models. And in the middle is, I think, where we fit here, particularly at this conference. In the middle is where we certainly are not looking at owning all of the IP and owning all of the engineers that deliver these custom hardware and software layers. but actually forming an open community, a rebel alliance, if you will, in Star Trek parlance. And being able to, you know, leverage the power of the community and primarily the enthusiasm of that expertise inside the community and come up with an alternative that tries to deliver the best of both worlds, tries to have a lot of expertise and innovation in a community context, but not necessarily have that expertise bound to one commercial company. And delivering the technology in a very, very open manner, where the classic model, of course, is to profit from the professional services or the support, but not at all from the licensing of that technology. And each of these business models has very direct, again, implications on the specific research and development strategy of these category of companies. A very popular blog, I guess it was Randy Bias, but some others have picked up on this concept, was written around the difference in this community between your pets and cattle. Meaning, and from an infrastructure perspective, you know, can you actually name and identify and hug a particular server, a particular rack in your data center, or are they so ubiquitous and so anonymous and so disposable and so replaceable that you've got an architecture mentality where you can effectively just roll them in, roll them out. Your application availability isn't impacted by any particular outage of a hardware component, or even sometimes, if you architect really well, an entire rack. That's the difference we're talking about here. And the way I see it, from a user perspective, from a developer perspective, from an infrastructure operational perspective, this is really not about polar opposites. You'll find this theme throughout a lot of my talks, including this one. It's not about a strict either or. It's very much about the spectrum. And where do you fall on that spectrum? And specifically around consumption models. How do you want to consume infrastructure in your OpenStack design? What we've seen in the marketplace continues to surprise me and at the same time reassure me. We actually see already these polar opposites. You're actually seeing a bunch of Raspberry Pi motherboards over there on the right, and a category of converged infrastructure, which is something that you might know brands like FlexPod, VBlock, HP, I forget what they call theirs, IBM's Pure Systems, and so forth. These models are both succeeding wildly in the marketplace, nowhere near at the expense of each other, which means at least at the polar ends of the spectrum, there's solid, you know, market-driven demand for both. And what's interesting is how the spectrum itself is widening out. So in our case, particularly at NetApp, what we're seeing is the ability now to enable our partners, our customers, to our developers inside and outside the company to consume our technology using a variety of different interfaces or flavors. Over on the left-hand side, you can start with these fully converged, fully integrated, extremely engineered racks. You can move gently over to say, you know what, I do want to do sort of a best-of-breed piecemeal approach. I don't want the entire thing fully converged for me. I want to pick and choose the best storage layer, the best file system layer, the best network layer, the best server layer, the best hypervisor layer. So be able to decompose that. And in our case, that really was where the business started, our classic appliance model. You actually see people decomposing even the appliance now, saying, you know what, I've already made investments in someone else's disk drives, or I can buy my disks way cheaper than you can provide them, or I value my disks a lot less than you value the pricing you give me. So why don't you decouple the disks from the actual controller, hardware or software that runs your technology? And that leads to a full software-only mode. Some people are, I think, incorrectly referring to this as software-defined storage now, the latest buzzword in the industry, but effectively a software-only implementation of technology we deliver that has no hardware bundled in, no disks bundled in, and depending on certain testing and hardware certification lists, you can essentially mix and match any controller and disk you want. And all the way to just a virtual instance, which can be a hypervisor-based instance or a cloud-based instance of a storage volume or a storage array, a virtual storage array in the cloud that you can manage, you can instantiate as easily and as elastically as you can any other resource in the cloud. You can manage as easily as you can any other resource in the cloud, and of course, deprovision or eliminate as well as any other resource in the cloud, but benefit from that strong desire for elasticity that exists there. So the ability to deliver these multiple consumption models is, I think, the key here, more than one particular religious flavor of all open source commodity versus fully engineered commercial rack. Hybrid clouds come up a lot. And I've always been reluctant to talk about the cloud bursting scenarios, which people love to theoretically discuss, but I've seen very, very few examples of in actual practice. Particularly compute and storage bursting. Particularly storage bursting is notoriously difficult. If you've actually seen Dave McCrory talk or seen his data gravity website or understand the concept of data gravity, you'll understand why literally it's hard. Data has gravity, has mass. Compared to compute, it's so much harder to move data around that it's easier to bring the compute to the data than it is to move the data to some commercially convenient compute, you know, facility. So as a result, the kind of hybrid cloud that we're seeing most popularly deployed in the marketplace is in some senses a recap or, you know, a back to the future moment of the old SAN and NAS days, where data center managers realized for flexibility and for maximum resource utilization, decoupling and separating compute from storage infrastructure and being able to network the two somehow gave you tremendous flexibility and dramatically increased either asset utilization or enabled dramatic, it was called server consolidation or file server consolidation in the old days, you know, dramatic reduction of unnecessary resources, physical capitalized resources. We're seeing the exact same thing now play out in the cloud era, where, and this is not a cloud era talk about Hadoop, this is the cloud era, and we're seeing it play out in that people are realizing for regulatory reasons, which I'll get to in a second, or for just personal, emotional reasons or financial reasons, they need to own the data, literally. They need to actually have the data sitting on their capitalized storage systems, but they still want to benefit from the tremendous compute elasticity available either in, you know, their own infrastructure clouds managed by OpenStack or third-party clouds, whether they're OpenStack-based or Amazon or other. So the notion of actually parking your data in colo facilities right next to cloud data centers and benefiting from very, very high-speed links between a public hyperscale cloud and that colo facility so that you can access the data as if it were in the cloud, but it's not, that's proving to be the most functional, usable, and popular hybrid cloud scenario out there, where you actually split the compute from the storage, and that's the hybrid boundary. So that's not what I expected years ago when I first got into the cloud business, but it is what's playing out right now. That's not to say this is the ultimate vision of where hybrid clouds go in the future, but this is reality today, and it's proving it's exceeding my expectations in terms of popularity. So actually, I guess I didn't touch on some of the regulations, but this kind of applies as well. The continuous integration discussion versus, you know, having more phased or staged adoption. This comes up a lot in developer-centric communities, particularly more dev than ops, where there's a strong desire to just push the code out, push it out, get it visible, get it used, debug it basically in production. And I think for a large class of technology we use today, 80% maybe of all the apps on our phones, that actually makes a lot of sense. You know, highly collaborative apps, apps that don't actually own the physical resiliency of the data, but just are consumers of the data. Those apps are perfect, I think, candidates for this kind of technology. And again, this comes back to the notion of, is your business all about data? Is your business data effectively, where you can do this? Or does your business use data in support of its other functions? And so this is why I think, you know, the analogy of eating raw sushi, or the sushi fail whale, where you can tolerate some outages, at least in the availability of the data. You certainly can't tolerate data loss, but availability of the data, performance, expectations, response time variability is tolerable, and so forth, versus having really a fine-cooked meal. And if you want to think of, you know, many, many categories, these six or so are just off the top of my head in various customer verticals that I talk to, of where it's completely unacceptable to debug in production and to push data out very, very rapidly. Think of you or one of your loved ones in surgery, in open heart surgery. Do you want any, and I mean any, of the software associated with the success of that surgery using a continuous integration model as it is today? I can tell you, I certainly don't. Think of, you know, how we all got here. Most of us don't live here. Whether it's airplanes and some of the control embedded systems in the aircraft itself, or whether it's the air traffic systems. And do you want rapid, continuous integration in all of these environments where, you know, literally it's the difference between life and death? No, I definitely want a much more planned, phased approach. Same thing for, you know, automotive control systems. If you buy a car today or over the last year or so, there is a, you know, literally frightening amount of lines of code in your car that are controlling your braking systems, controlling your airbags when they should or shouldn't be deployed, controlling your lighting, controlling, you know, certainly if you take advantage of some of the more sophisticated, you know, cruise controls now, controlling the distance between you and the car ahead of you and some cars behind you and so forth. I'm not even talking about the Google car that we see on the 101 all the time in the Valley, right? These are things you and I can buy outside of Mountain View. And we are buying and we are driving right now. Millions upon tens of millions, hundreds of millions of lines of source code there. I don't want that. In fact, I don't think I can have that continuously integrated. Same thing for military systems, whether they're drones or tanks or battleships or what have you. You know, let's make sure we debug those. Nuclear power plants, I'd like that software to be very, very well thought out and tested. And the one that I actually get beat up on every day, maybe just because it's a vocal community or maybe because it's New Yorkers definitely like to let you know how they feel, is in Wall Street. They suffer from, and you know, the IT guys really do suffer, the analysts benefit, but the IT guys really suffer from an overwhelming amount of regulation, you know, post Lehman Monday, post the dot-bomb crash and all these other financial crashes we've had. And they literally can't. They haven't figured out a model for rapid continuous integration in their business. So they, even though they'd like to be able to offer you more services and more weird financial, you know, constructs to be able to buy artificially and get into another crisis, they just can't. There's too many regulations right now preventing you from doing that. All right, so switching gears now to OpenStack specifically. One of the other things we've observed is many, many customers looking that are non-developers particularly, that are not directly involved in an OpenStack project. So this is the majority now of people in the OpenStack world, if you will, on the customer side, are very, very confused as to what storage really means in the OpenStack world. Because out of the gate, out of the bat, there's automatically in this dashboard, as you can tell if you develop actively, is already a couple of versions old, but it still illustrates the point. There's two different kinds. It's looking like my favorite joke in the Blues Brothers movie. There's two different kinds of music, country and Western. same thing in storage here. There's really two different kinds of storage, even though it's all OpenStack. There's the compute, you know, application-oriented storage in support of the compute side, particularly all the instances that we have, and we know it as volumes today, the Cinder project in the OpenStack world. And then there's a container or object view, which is a vastly, vastly different technology, vastly different interface. And more importantly, one of the things we keep observing is that whereas you just merely stop at the abstraction and the interface for how volumes are created and managed and deprovisioned and associated with Nova instances and so forth, the Swift project is all about how you implement the technology as well as the interfaces, the object interfaces to your containers. And we think sometimes that's a little bit too much of a tight coupling there. That's too a little bit too symbiotic and perhaps not healthy for the future of OpenStack and even Swift as a whole. So this is, you know, if you're a Dickens fan as well, this is really very much today in the OpenStack world a tale of two cities. You've got the revolution going on, a lot of rapid development and emerging technology in the OpenStack, in the Open Swift, the ring space, and you've got relative maturity over on the compute side when it comes to a very well-defined model with Cinder for how you create volumes, how associate volumes with compute instances and so forth. And I think the deployment and adoption model, certainly from the feedback, customer feedback we get, reflects that. So let's take a pause here. Take a deep breath, because this is the busiest slide by far. And I apologize in advance for the amount of animation in this slide, but it's really the only way to get the point across. Back to the theme of diversity. Customers have choice, and specifically the community we care most about here, developers all over the technology sector have choice. And this is really the, I think, the flora fauna, if you will, the entire diverse ecosystem that they have available to them. A lot of it, as I mentioned earlier, includes commercial options as well as proprietary commercial service options. So not just open software, not just free services. Although curiously enough, the honeypot model here is that a lot of these developer and development environments, these IDEs, are often offered up as a freemium model or a very, very low cost of entry model. But there's, again, a wide diversity at the top in terms of application, development. I'm not talking about deployment yet, but application development platforms. And in fact, you know, I kind of wish in hindsight that I was about 20 or 30 years older for a number, or younger for a number of reasons. But the first one, probably the geek side of me, is I just love IDEs today. And the ability to develop in the cloud and not even have to buy the hardware or worry about keeping up with the latest, you know, PC or laptop processor speed for crispness of the IDE, that's just a tremendous luxury that people, I think, that didn't live in the old days like me, the caveman days of computing, you really shouldn't take it for granted. It's just amazingly wonderful time to be a developer, and these services reflect that. But it is a honeypot model. Remember, none of these guys are in there for charity. Here's where I would be scared to death if this was thrust upon me today. At the data layer, the breadth and depth now, but especially the breadth of options for persisting data is maybe not for young developers who grew up, you know, I don't think a lot of developers are digital natives yet, but they're close. But for me of my era, you know, when I learned relational and set theory was pounded into me in university, this would scare the crap out of me. There's just too much choice here. I'm familiar with, you know, literally the polar ends of this. I'm familiar with the relational model when I grew up and just, you know, simple file block interfaces to persisting data. But now we've got tons of options for column stores, native document stores, the uber popular key value stores, and just object interfaces, rich object interfaces of all kinds, and some very, very rich batch services now that are led by the Hadoop community in particular. And the thing about this is it's the new reality. Some of the logos underneath each one of these categories may consolidate. And, you know, it's just a natural effect of maturing industries. But what will not go away is literally those categories themselves. So we are in a world now where literally a polyglot data world where we do have to be very, very comfortable and familiar with these various different kinds of data layers, data services layers. And the OpenStack community has to, I haven't seen it yet really, has to embrace all of them if you really want to become truly mainstream and want to have higher and higher orders of value to the developers in this world, because developers are using all of these and we don't want to have an infrastructure layer that's bound to just a subset. Again, the infrastructure layer itself is getting very, very interesting right now, because now we're talking about not app development, but app deployment. And it's very seductive once you've developed one of these applications with a very sexy GUI and IDE to just click, you know, deploy and have it hosted on the same platform you developed it on. That also has, of course, a lot of long-term consequences. Can be a higher cost of ownership, higher cost of delivery, and of course the ubiquitous concern around supplier lock-in, services lock-in, you know, service provider lock-in, vendor lock-in, call it what you will. So being able to abstract as much as possible across the data services, across the infrastructure services, and this is where I will put in my shameless plug for CDMI, the Cloud Data Management Interfaces. At the data layer, being able to abstract, particularly for object and containers, between any one particular kind of RESTful interface, whether it's S3, Swift, or other that comes along, whether it's a service or an actual array, a product, that abstraction can be incredibly powerful. Because at the very least, it has, you know, I would say twofold major benefit, two high-level benefits. One, of course, is if you're an application developer, you code to the abstracted API, and now the data, the namespaces you create, in fact, can either move seamlessly between back-end storage systems or providers or both, or of course you can create hybrid namespaces effortlessly by essentially just mapping the namespace across an intelligent abstraction layer that can abstract multiple back-end clouds, multiple back-end storage systems, or any combination thereof. So as a developer, it's a real wonderland to be able to create these rich hybrid namespaces and not have to worry about the physical location of your data anymore. That decoupling of physical from logical is incredibly powerful and useful. And in fact, what I've seen is the only way to manage the data at scale that we're managing right now, the quote unquote big data we're all dealing with. Now, from an operations perspective, there's tremendous benefit as well. Because again, at the operations level, you're the one that has to actually bind these applications to something that runs them. And if you physically and very tightly bind these applications to specific infrastructure, specific vendors, or specific service providers, you're just locked in again. And you have very little power, very little leverage, and it might be a very easy decision, you know, initially, but a very, very painful and expensive decision over time. So abstraction layers across multiple storage systems, storage services, cloud providers is a big theme I'm seeing as the cloud market overall, not just OpenStack, matures. I actually do see these delineated boundaries in terms of customer behavior almost every year. In 2013, it keeps coming back and kind of slapping me in the face in all my customer discussions. 2013 is a year of paranoia around cloud lock-in, whether it's storage services or service providers as a whole. And people are thinking about it now. No one's really doing anything about it yet, but people are thinking about it, and it's a very healthy and important thing to think about. Because again, the two main options right now are to end up either in a commercial ecosystem like VMware's or a very, very popular but private and proprietary ecosystem like Amazon's. And those can't be the only two options. Okay, so narrowing down to the end here, distributed versus centralized control. This is another kind of like continuous integration religious topic here. And what I find fascinating is observing what's happening in real time right now around the different mindsets being applied to the exact same collective OpenStack project. You've got Quantum taking advantage of all the hype and actually practical benefits of software-defined networking that are centralizing control in the architecture versus having a very, very distributed network control in the past. But on the storage side, you've got the exact opposite. It's kind of the Wild West cowboy days of everyone wanting fully distributed everything when it comes to storage and not really realizing some of the dangers and the ramifications of that. So it's really fascinating that the networking world is coming full circle, and of course, it's inevitable that the storage world will come full circle. And because, as with many things in computer science, this is where having a bit of gray hair, or no hair at all in my case right now, but having that experience is extremely beneficial. Because as we can date back to 1962 here, Paul Barron, and some of the research he did around distributed networks and distributed network architectures, there's always a tension between centralized models and, it never looks like a ring in real world. That's what it looks like in real world, distributed models. And a hybrid sort of decentralized approach we're finding at the storage layer has tremendous benefits. And here's specifically why. Resiliency. This is sort of the number one thing that comes up in a storage discussion is how can we implement low-cost resiliency and stick to, avoid vendor lock-in, use commodity open source hardware and software components. And the reality is, you can. But if you take a look at the most mature implementations of ring storage technology, Amazon's Dynamo and Amazon's S3 that's based on that same technology, how many copies do you think? And I don't think I'm revealing proprietary information here, but I do know the answer, and I'm going to see if anyone in the audience knows. How many physical copies do you think S3 deploys to deliver the very impressive level of resiliency that they do deliver right now? Anyone willing to take a stab?
Three.
Hearing two and three, and I'm going to be like an auctioneer. Any higher bids?
13.
Much closer. I heard 13 in the front. It's actually, you overshot it. It's 11. So forget about this theory of three copies and you're safe. Okay, in practice, in the real world, 11 copies, physical copies of your data, are required to deliver resiliency at scale. It is fundamentally broken unless you run an interesting business model that Amazon runs for all sorts of reasons. Sorry? Three logical. Trust me, I'm talking about physical copies here. And we have a bit of time at the end, so we can certainly have a discussion about it offline. The reason why we prefer the decentralized approach in the middle here is that we don't think erasure coding versus RAID, which are, by the way, different flavors of the same math. It's basically parity versus linear algebra, but it's fundamentally similar math. We don't think this is an either-or discussion. We have done, whether it's across all of NetApp engineering or specifically in the office of the CTO with university academic partnerships, with internal research projects and specific models that we've created, we've done a tremendous amount of research in this topic. And our final conclusion is that the closer you get to the disk, the closer you have these really rapid interconnects, these high-speed backplanes, passive or active, whether they're PCI or much more sophisticated than that, the closer you get to the disk, the better it is to use parity-based RAID to recover efficiently, cost-effectively from these physical outages, these disk-level outages. The further you get from a disk, so particularly you know, groups of shelves or nodes, if you will, in most of these common designs, and you want to be able to protect data efficiently instead of 11 copies, way less than that, less than 2 copies to do it intelligently. If you want to do that across nodes, particularly at distance, so when you're getting outside of PCI or memory bus territory and into Ethernet territory and wide area networking technology, that's where erasure coding makes a ton of sense. Because some of the latencies inherent in some of the compute overhead and doing the reconstruct are masked by just the general latency of the interconnects themselves. So a best of both worlds, and you know, I'm not going to pre-announce anything here, but future technologies from NetApp are going to include best of both worlds here. Going to include both of these concepts in very, very widely scalable, very low-cost hyperscale storage infrastructures. So that was 10, but of course, we're all engineers here. We all love Spinal Tap. So this list goes to 11. And this is a perfect example of us contributing something back specifically to the OpenStack community. Rob here on the side, and he'll be happy to take questions later on, along with Ben, who I think is in the audience as well. There you are. Have already published a proposal, including a blueprint, for a shares service, a file sharing service. So aside from some of the strong technical benefits for considering file-based as opposed to just purely block-based services for Cinder or you know other constructs as the case may be over time, just take a look at the market. You know, IDC has tracked the latest full year that they have data for, 2012, of all the storage that's not in our laptops, not in our phones, but actual managed storage in data centers, 2/3 of it are not block interface. So I know that the community here is all about rapid development and iteration, but why on earth would you want to ignore 2/3 of the market? I can't think of a single reason. You got to embrace this market if we want OpenStack to become mainstream, which means embracing all of it, not just 1/3 of it. So I think regardless of whether this particular proposal wins out or not, and it's been very well thought out, and it's 18 months, 2 years old at least right now, so there's a lot of iteration built into it, there is a desperate need for more than just a block or object storage service in OpenStack. And again, the market has spoken, the market wants this technology, and there's very, very practical benefits. Again, this is back to the future for me 10, 15 years ago, SAN and NAS days. You know, if you're able to centralize control, either at a file system level or even an object level, and be able to offer a POSIX-based file interface as a volume that multiple instances can simultaneously share as opposed to just be bound one-to-one to, there's huge scaling benefits there. There's huge efficiencies of scaling benefits there. And actual data sharing possibilities within the instances of your apps that are incredibly powerful and are being delivered, by the way, by VMware. I'm not sure so much in Amazon. You can kind of hack it easily, but it's not a native service yet. But are being delivered already. And of course, there's dependencies in non-virtualized non-cloud data centers inside enterprises today on this technology. So again, as you can tell, I'm pretty passionately lobbying for the community as a whole to seriously look at this proposal, comment on it, improve it, or say, you know what, it's crap, here's a much better implementation, but there is an implementation needed for ultimate mainstream OpenStack success in this marketplace. And in a couple of minutes I have left, I'll kind of wrap on some things beyond the top 10 list that after observing the community that we need to look forward to and we need to plan for. So one of my favorite futurists, one of the only futurists really that I follow, that I've met, but a guy that hopefully you've heard of because Google's employed him now and gosh knows what he's going to be doing inside Google right now, but Ray Kurzweil. If you don't know who he is, look him up, Google him please. He has actually done some fascinating analysis of how technology, dating back to the Industrial Revolution, the rate at which technology progresses. So a different kind of continuous integration, if you will. And what he's observed is fascinating because it's so counterintuitive to how humans feel or think. He has observed now, there's no doubt anymore here, right? This is just mathematically plotted and proven, that technology progresses exponentially, not linearly as we think as humans. So what are the ramifications here? Well, as you can read, and he actually, the model he uses is the power of computing you can hold in your hand. One of the things he was famous for, in addition to just doing this research and publishing it, he actually applied it very early on. He delivered for hearing impaired people a handheld device that looks like an iPhone, but this predates the iPhone by almost 10 years, handheld device that was able to actually be able to, you know, intonate some of their words or be able to actually translate some of the things that they were the device was hearing so that they could hear it. So this is a very, very early version of Google Translate, if you will. He delivered that a long, long time ago, about 12 years ago now. And he keeps postulating on what this graph specifically illustrates is how much power you'll be able to hold in your hand in the shape of an iPhone-style device, not a phablet, something even smaller than that. And what he says is around, if I'm reading this right, I keep forgetting the dates, around 2050 or so, 2040, 2050, the collective power of an entire human brain. Okay, this is a lot of brain power, this is, pardon the pun, a lot of CPU power, will be available in a handheld device, in one single handheld device. That's how much power you'll have. Today, an entire human brain still can't be modeled across multiple vast data centers that a Google or a Facebook or an Amazon would own. There's still all the synapses firing. Until we get to quantum computing, still require an enormous amount of CPU power. By 2080, that handheld device will be able to have the collective wisdom and processing power of all of humanity in a handheld device. So this is really how rapidly technology is progressing. It's not just about, you know, emulating an insect brain or a mouse brain. The human brain, as you can tell, follows very quickly thereafter. So we're very early on in the OpenStack evolution phase. We're still in single letters, not double letters yet. We haven't even got to half of the alphabet. And one of the things I've learned being at NetApp for 15 years and managing complex software projects is that you've really got to plan ahead. And you've really got to start not just architecting with a very clear view of the future, but running parallel development streams if you can. A TikTok model for development, not just thinking one release ahead only. And if you don't think the theory is practical, here's some of the science, or the actual practical reality. One example of why this is so important at the storage layer is that by the end of the decade, we will not recognize what storage looks like, managed storage looks like. What we have, again, from a storage perspective in our hands, in an Android device, a BlackBerry, an iPhone, what have you, is trivial. It's all solid state based, which is interesting. But the revolution that's coming in storage is not about better tapes, which will still exist at the end of the decade, by the way, or better disks, which will still exist, but in a shockingly singular format only. It's about how memory is becoming more like storage than storage is like memory. And how tiering of RAM and tiering of memory and processing data, first copies of data in memory literally, is what the future of applications and computing are all about. And there's no better time than right now in the OpenStack community to start architecting for that. Working with industry associations such as SNEA, where Intel has a technical working group around non-volatile memory extensions to instruction sets, to libraries, I/O libraries. Again, the whole notion of I/O and in-memory computing is an oxymoron. So you've got to really rethink about how you persist in-memory data structures and how you manage in-memory data structures across nodes, across racks, across data centers, because data management never goes away. But certainly some of the technologies and the incredibly rapid processing power and latencies available by managing data over the memory bus as opposed to over an Ethernet connection, that's a really, really powerful construct that's upon us. And by the end of the decade, it'll be, you know, we predict, widely deployed because it'll be commercially affordable. So I'm happy to take questions later on about the specific flavors we're talking about here. And I guess that is my last slide. So with that, I've got about 5 more minutes. Thank you. So there's a microphone here, I think, for posterity in the recording. We're probably going to have to ask people to either step up there or, of course, if there's no group questions, I'll be happy to entertain them one-on-one.
Yeah, 2 quick things, Val. One, I'm a little disappointed you didn't float the idea we discussed of renaming OpenStack Skynet. And 2 is the proposal is, in fact, actually prototype code for the file share service. So FYI. Thanks.
Great. Thanks for the reminder. And the Skynet reference is very true. Other times when I give this talk, I say, you know, is the future of the data center science or science fiction? Because literally a lot of the science fiction concepts are becoming science and reality. All right. I'm guessing not a lot of people want to go up to the mic, so thank you, and I'll take questions one-on-one after.